So, I think we are ready to start. Welcome to my talk, How to Break an 18-Year-Old Monolith. Today I want to show you how we created the monolith over several years, and I also want to show you what we are doing to break it now. A few words about myself. My name is Andreas Breu. I'm a software developer from Berlin. Ages ago, I studied computer science with a focus on databases. On my job and even on my hobby projects, I do a lot of DevOps tasks, and I'm a member of the Freifunk.net initiative in Germany. It's an initiative about free and wireless open networks. We want to provide easy access for users to networks, easy access, easy and free access to the internet for a lot of people. And of course, I do like open source software. I contribute a lot to open source software, and I use a lot of more of open source software. So that's a great thing we have here. My company, Idealo, it's a price comparison portal founded in Berlin in the year 2000. We are active with our price comparison in Germany, Austria, France, and some other countries. And we do have about 800 employees in Berlin. We only have the office in Berlin. It's not distributed over several countries. And more of 200 of those employees are developers in our company. In my talk, I first want to show you some features of the Idealo website, because I'm always coming back to that and talking about that so that you can that you have a picture in mind of it. And in the first part, we look back into history, how and why we created the monolith. And at the end, I want to show you our plans and steps we took to break the monolith. These are some screenshots from our website. First, you can see the our category page. It's an overview page for users coming to Idealo and looking for products, and it's also an entry point if you're looking for a specific thing like knives. In this example, you can use filters, and you can filter by prices and other things that are special for knives, for example. And so users start here if they want to buy such a product, and they usually come to the next page. It's the product page, where we have all the product details on a page with a data sheet and a price chart, how the price developed over the last month. And the most important thing is the offer list you can find on this page to go to the shop at the end and buy the product you want, if the product itself is that's what you really want. If you want to buy a product but the price is too high, we have a feature called Price Alert. With this feature, you can set your price you want to buy the product for, and usually it's lower than the price you can see on the website, so it doesn't make sense to get a price alert for a higher price. But you can set a lower price than we actually have, and you'll get a notification about this via email, via app, and so on. And fourth feature I'm talking about in my talk is the so-called wish list. Users can store products on the wish list. They compare products. They see price drops there, or if the price got higher in comparison to the last time they viewed. And it's just a tool for users to manage their products they want to buy. But let's go back to the year 2000. At this time, Idealo started with two developers, and they started developing a software that could do everything that was needed for Idealo. It was maintainable for them because they were only two people, and they added some features like the product page and the category page, and later they also added the feature called Price Alert, and of course all the data we see on our website has to be maintained. We have product pictures, we have product details, so we needed some content tools, so our content editor department can also add data or modify data or add new products and so on. The other important things are offers, so we can get the offer list and we get offers delivered by shops, and for these shops we also need the shop tools to have the shop data there. There are some ratings for shops and so on, some features. And in the beginning we only had one front-end artifact. It was the German Idealo website we deployed, and there were only a few kind of page types within this application. Everything was deployed in a manual way. There was no deployment scripts and no CI system that was used, but with two and in the end maybe 10 developers, it was easier than it was at the end for us. In the first days, Idealo looked like this. This is a screenshot from 2005. And it felt like having such a nice colored bike and driving it and driving around. But we go farther in the next period between 2008 and 2014. We had some more features added, for example, the wishlist features I showed you. And we expanded to more countries to provide our services also in other countries like Austria and France. And so we had to add internationalization features. We also added a REST API there, so third-party consumers, customers could use the data on their own websites. And it was also we also tried to not only have the coupling with the front ends itself. By the way, the front ends, the international front ends have been own artifacts at this time. We didn't deploy it with together with the German artifact, and so it was heavy to deploy it. There were some deployment scripts at these times, but only on someone's machines, so we had a few people that knew about how to deploy the software. The people worked with feature branches at this time, and someone had to merge all the changes together to the master branch before deployment, and so they couldn't commit any new features about 2 weeks before a new deployment started. And the number of developers grew from 10 to 30 developers in this time, and we also increased the number of products. In the first period, there were only 1 million products, and now there have been 3 million products there, with a lot of properties and dependencies to other tables in the database, so that got more and more complex, and we can also see it in the screenshot from 2008. On the category page, there are a bunch of more details. There are logos of shops, there are test ratings. We try to display everything for the user that they can find it on a single page. And it felt like having such a tall bike with a lot of extensions installed, and it still made fun, I guess, to ride it, but it got harder to get on the bike and use it. So it was still hard, or it got harder to use the software and maintain the software at all. And so Idealo tried a first split in 2014. We tried to split the monolith we had so far into a front-end component, into a back-end component, and we extracted the REST API. And everything we extracted based on the common tools and libraries you can see on the top left corner, because everything was bundled with a single database, and the data layer still resided in the common tools and libraries. There we also got more features for this software, so the more countries have been added to the front end artifacts. We also got mobile pages. At this time we had two artifacts for the mobile side and for the desktop side, so it was displayed in a completely different way. I'm not sure why they didn't use responsive web design at this moment. Maybe it was not so good at this time. The REST API was used for smartphone apps. We started very early with iPhone apps and Android apps and so on to provide something for the users. And there were also third-party services that still used our REST API. On the backend side, there haven't been so much changes. Of course, the content tools got adapted from time to time. And also the offer services, the offer stream from the shops always got extended because we got more and more shops on it, and we had to store more and more data, and the frequency got higher every time you looked on it, because the shops changed the prices and so on. In this times, we slowly moved, especially for the front-end artifacts, to daily deployments. We migrated all the deployment scripts to Ansible. We increased the test coverage for the software. Especially test coverage was difficult because the software was never written for having a lot of unit tests. And so people started writing end-to-end tests and UI tests, but this was complicated because the tests were very unstable. We had a lot of flickering tests, and it was more exploratory testing than unit testing or integration testing. And so the build of the software of the front-end artifacts took us more than 1 hour if it succeeded. If one of the tests failed, we had to repeat it until all tests succeeded. And the deployment itself to all the servers took us 35 minutes. So it was quite a nice time with the software to deploy it. And we also always tried to have a modern software stack. There was also always the most recent Java version we used for it. We used Spring Boot. We tried to replace all the special features we built in the old times to replace it with the default things, like, for example, a white space filter. We had a white space filter in there. It worked really good. No one really knew why it worked so good, but it was better than the default one. So we had to use it still some more times, but at the end we could replace it. Doing changes in the software was really heavy. The number of developers working on the same code base increased to 50 people working on the same software repository. And we also got more and more products and properties of products and dependencies in there. So it got really more and more complex at the end from every side of view. At these days, Idealo looked like this. We had extended the website by a filter bar on the top, and we had tiles for our products. And I think this is a development we can still see today on our website. And writing the monolith felt like having such a freight bike with a lot of stuff on there, and maybe something fell down on the way, and no one knows how to replace it again. So what did you do in 2017? We did another split. We tried to split within the front-end artifacts all the or some of the page types we have there, like the product page and category page. So some of them were easy to extract because they had their own domain model and they didn't use so much data. Others have been harder to extract, like product page and category page. So we tried it that way. On the other hand, we unified a lot of front ends. There was no international front end anymore, no mobile front end anymore. All front ends got united in a single front end. And so we could reduce the number of page types and artifacts. And we also achieved to have less dependencies between teams and departments, because all of the page types, like they are extracted, belong to a different team or department. But you can see there is still the part of common libraries and tools, and we still use the single centralized database to store everything. And the number of developers also increased to 60 people working on the code. The number of products, of course, increased more and more. And the only thing that we could reduce was the number of front-end artifacts and page types. And for teams, that meant we could reduce build times and deployment times. I was in the team that built the category page. This category page deployment took us at the end 10 minutes, and the build about 20 minutes. So it was good to have the split at the time, as we could increase the speed on working on new features. This is how the product category page looks today. There haven't been so much changes since 2017. But what do you think? Did that help, what we do? I think the correct answer is it depends. Because, yes, it helped. Some of our services have been splitted by responsibility. The splitted artifacts could delete a lot of code that they didn't need anymore. We could deploy the artifacts independently when nothing changed at the common tools and libraries. So every team was able to deploy when they wanted to deploy and how often they wanted to deploy. And we also could reduce the number of dependencies, because with this split, we managed it to extract all the writing stuff, things that have been writing to the database, because the category page only reads from the database. So it helped us in a way, but there's also a no. We do have still the centralized database. We do also share components and libraries over all the products. If we want to make changes on the shared components that also include the data layer, every single artifact has to do deployment at the same time, else we could have problems reading or writing to the database. And another thing is, some important business logic is still in these old parts of the code. A lot of people that wrote that code already left the company. The code is years old, and new people coming to the company don't have enough knowledge about these components. And also the kind of how the software was written, of course, changed completely. And so that was still hard to read and improve that code. And it feels like, you can see on that bike, we can get faster, we can have more fun on that bike, but we all have the same speed and the same direction of driving. And so that was not the solution we all wanted. So we asked ourselves, what should we do next? In the meantime, we had some incidents with the old parts of the software. We tried the first things. We tried to restart the software. Did you try turn it on and off again? And no one really could really understand what happened there and why it happened there. And it was really complicated to get into the old software, find the bugs, or try to improve it. And that made us really slow in getting new features, especially when we needed to change a data layer or something like that. And so often changes only have been cosmetics to their front ends, and everything else we wanted to change didn't work. So we had a lot of questions in 2018. It was after the experience of cutting out parts of the software. We ask ourselves, should we continue extracting just parts of the software and still sharing components and other libraries? This process was really slow and didn't improve so much for us. And we also asked, does it scale? I think it doesn't scale because we don't win anything if we just use old software and strip out code that isn't needed for artifact. And it also happens that we have parts of the code no one feels responsible for. And as I said before, there is a lot of code with important business logic that we need there. So we ask ourselves, should we replace parts of the monolith with new components, just try anything really new? And so we decided to extract domain by domain and replace them by completely new services with a new data storage, with new communication and so on. We wanted to have lightweight services that could be easily deployed. We wanted to have really continuous deployment, just committing to the master or merging something to the master, and everything works on its own. So we maybe can achieve times where we just commit something to master and 10 minutes later it is live in production. And that was one of the goals, and so we built a team to extract things. We just decided to practice on a smaller domain to do that. A domain we could handle easily, like for example the wishlist domain, but it was something else. We designed the services to be able to transfer to other teams because we only have been the migration team for the services, and so the service contained everything it needed to be run, for also the CI and CD deployment tool, so that they really could use it if they want to have the service on their own. This was a really slow process to do it because we should do some work, and there was no effort on features a customer could see or the business owners could see. It was just we did our work when nothing happened. We did our work good, and but we had a lucky situation. We got important notes from our database admins, and this note was, they don't want to support our hardware and software for the central database anymore in 2019. And this gave us really a lot of drive and the backing by the business owners, because if we can't guarantee that the database will run anymore, the whole website will be down and so on. And this allowed us to really focus on the migration of the things. Of course, this was really fast for us because I think we got the message in summer 2018 or maybe late summer, and we started a project in October 2018 to extract everything from this database and from the our monolith. And we should have ended in June. Of course, it didn't work at all so fast, but we reached a lot of important steps. So What was our main goal? Before this message, we had a goal. We want to extract the service, improve the obvious mistakes that have been made in the data structure, in the domain model, and so on. But we had to change our goal a bit because we had to be very much faster than in the plan before. So we didn't want to improve too much on the first attempt, just things that we had to do. Our goal was also to transform services to self-contained systems. We didn't want any blocking synchronous calls to other services anymore. We also wanted to introduce consumer-driven contract tests to avoid complex staging setups in our company, because when we build more and more services, it gets harder to get the staging every time in the right way. And we also built and extended a team for migration services. And I was part of this team, or I still am part of this team. So let me explain some of our goals. Why did we want to move it to self-contained systems? Before that, we had a lot of discussions in the whole company. Should we use microservices and use Fuse to aggregate the front-end together by a front-end component? Or should we use self-contained systems? It's the completely other way, because a self-contained system contains everything you need to run it. You don't have direct dependencies to other services. You have a storage system within your self-contained system. You have the backend, the business logic, and of course, you also can provide a front-end. You may not have a front-end if you just a service producing something and sending messages, but most of the services still have, at least have a small front-end for administration, for example. And every self-contained system is an autonomous web application. It works on its own. If another service fails, this application still runs. Very important is that it is owned by exactly one team. And we try to be asynchronous wherever possible. A self-contained system is not something that shares UI with other self-contained systems, and it doesn't, of course, it doesn't share business code with other self-contained systems. Of course, we have a lot of code and data duplication within our systems now, but the main advantage for us was that the self-contained systems don't touch each other so much, and they will run even if other systems don't run anymore. So we want to be message driven. So we said, don't call us, we call you if we have a change for you. And every service should work with, for example, Apache Kafka. We introduced in my department Apache Kafka to provide data for other services. Don't want other services to pull us directly via REST calls. We don't have a REST API at the end for our services. To reach that, or one of the goals behind it is to reduce the coupling behind of services. You are not dependent to the other service. Of course, you are dependent to Apache Kafka and that it runs. For example, if the Kafka thing is not available, your service still runs. You may have old data in your system, but the service is still running, and you don't need to care about the other service. One thing that was new for us is our data is now eventually consistent. We can't guarantee consistency anymore, but especially in our front-end artifacts, we don't need consistency 100%. So if some messages come later or we have to resend messages, that's enough for our cases, and so we don't need to put too much effort in consistency. How do we reach the goals? Maybe some of you have heard about the Strangler pattern to get from an old monolith to a new self-contained system. So building a facet for the clients or consumers to query data via the facet or to talk to the service. And in the back, you just rebuild the legacy software with the modern software. And at the end, you can remove the facet from this system. But we had some challenges that didn't work for us to use that kind of pattern, because the most important thing, our shared components that we use with all the artifacts, and they include the data layer. So it was just not possible to build anything in front of the legacy components, because every artifact still included it via dependency. We also have a lot of producers and a lot of consumers using the software, and this would not have been easy to create a facet for them all, and all of them also wanted to change things, so the Big Bang wasn't possible for us. And so we decided to provide data migration from and to the legacy systems if we extract a new service. This was a thing we also did, we already did before we knew that we don't get any support for the database anymore. And in these times, we also didn't know that we have to break the monolith so fast. And so it was just it was a decision we made before, but we also saw that we couldn't use the Strangler pattern at the end, because there were too many dependencies we couldn't resolve in that time. So our migration strategy looks like that. We have our legacy monolith with legacy producers and legacy services that use it, and in the first step, we create a forwards migration to, or we create some kind of our extracted service, and also build a forwards migration to migrate data from the legacy monolith. If someone produces data with the legacy producer, we also get the data sent to our new service. And even if we want to update data in the extracted service, we talk to a migration service that writes the data back to the monolith, so that everyone who consumes the data from the legacy monolith is still able to use the data, and the data is up to date. After this, we can add new producers and new consumer services for the extracted service, and if one of those things exists, we can, for example, remove the a legacy producer, and we don't need the forwards migration anymore for this parts of this extracted service, of course. And at the end, we can hopefully remove also the legacy consumer, and we don't need the legacy, the backwards migration to the legacy monolith anymore. And at the end, we hopefully can delete this software. So, this helps us to give teams the time to renew their software, to learn the new technologies they need, so they can decide on their own when to change to the new software or use the new producer or being the new consumer. And we hope we don't need to run it a very long time, because it's a bit unstable every time, because there are some old things that are not tested in the monolith, and if we write data there from another source, it can be complicated. So let's come to an example. My team first extracted catalog data. The catalog is the heart of the Idealo website. It provides, for example, a category tree where users can navigate through categories and subcategories and find the product they are maybe looking for. We are also storing attributes within the product catalog. It contains things, properties of products, and things we can filter the product. We have things like a manufacturer and so on. There is a data sheet on every product page that also contains all the attributes we have for product, and all the attributes are also configured for a specific category. So, of course, we don't have the frame size or the frame material in categories that are not bikes. And there are also tiles for information that also contains the product data. So you see the product catalog is on nearly every page type we have at Idealo. And so our new product catalog service looks like. It's extracted from the legacy monolith. It has its own database. It should now be the single source of truth for product data. And this service provides several topics for every entity we do have in this service. We provide an own topic, so users can consume data from different topics. Also, if they need to aggregate data with other topics like offers, for example, the product page you remember also displays offers from shops. They can just use another topic they consume to just aggregate the data within that. And on the left side, we can see the producers, maybe in the future, the content producers and the product catalog service will merge into a single product, into a single artifact. So this kind of service is quite simple in comparison with that what we had before, what you can see on the corner. You may wonder how we now apply common business rules. Every domain is extracted and provides data via topics, Apache Kafka topics, for example, and the product catalog service, for example, only provides raw data. There is nothing aggregated in this topic. We don't want to store aggregated data in the single source of truth, because there is some business rule we want to apply. And one really simple example is the product title we can see here. The product title always consists of the name of the manufacturer that is stored in a single domain entity, and it contains also the product name that is in my example subcross 40, and the manufacturer is Scott. And the business rule says we have to add the product name and the manufacturer name to get a valid product title. And so we decided to build an aggregator service. This aggregator service just takes data from several topics, applies a lot of rules, and creates aggregated items, so users or consumers can use this data. And if we want to say, hey, this is an important business rule and we want to have this displayed on every page of our company in the same way, then you just have to use the aggregated product topic, for example. The other alternative would have been that everyone applies the business rule on their own, but this may not work. If we decide that we change the product name and the manufacturer name, or we add some other property to it, then every consumer that applies this rule had to change their way of doing it. So we hope that everyone uses this aggregator service, but it makes it easy for consumers to use it, because not every thing we apply in common business rules is so easy, like the product title we can see here. How did our teamwork change? You can see now we have every team has their own bike, so we can decide on speed and direction ourselves. all the teams now can focus on the work on their product, on the product they own, on the service they own. So we don't need to talk to each other if we want to make a change to the data layer or if we want to update some libraries in the common libraries and tools. They have to do it on their own. They are responsible for their own service. So that kind of coordination overhead could be reduced. Of course, we still talk to each other if we want to add new features or new things, for example, to the product catalog, or if we want to change the API, we just talk to each other. And what helps us in those kinds of talking, we use contract tests to prevent breaking deployments. For example, if we remove a field from our topic, we have contract tests and our build pipeline will fail if we don't fulfill the contract anymore. And so that helps us. Contract tests don't eliminate all risks of API changes because it's an example-based testing. If a consumer just doesn't use or just doesn't ask for a specific field in a contract test, of course, the contract test will pass and maybe the deployment at the client side will fail or something else will fail. And but it helps us to see if we can remove some things. What have been our key learnings from this project? The most important thing for me is set an end of lifetime for products and services, so you can get the pressure to do it, to change anything, and also other teams see the need to change anything. If something is not supported anymore, then they have to do something if they still want to use it. We also learned that we need independence for teams. Teams have to be independent for deployments, for tools they use, for the programming language they use. So the teams now can decide how to build or how to create their own service. This was just an example for the services my teams build. Other teams may use services in another way. The only thing we decided on in the company is that we want to use the self-contained systems. What we also learned, or what we already knew before, is that the service should be owned exactly by one team that's responsible for it. Doesn't help that many teams are working on the same code base. We had it before that three teams tried to deploy the software, the front-end artifacts. Every 3 weeks, our team used to deploy the services, and the other 2 weeks, other teams were responsible for deployment. And this was also very, very complicated because my team was very experienced in deployments, and the other teams haven't had this experience, and they also always asked us if something failed in the deployment. And at the end, we said, okay, we do the deployment every week, every time, every day, and you just give us pull requests. And so we had to work for deployments, but it was easier for us to maintain it. We also decided to use contract tests in favor of staging environments, because when you have a lot of services, you want to test against each other. It gets really complicated to maintain all the dependencies between the staging systems. You always need to look if there is some data, maybe a copy of the live database within your staging environment, and this was not the way we wanted to work anymore. And a lot of teams learned feature toggles to use when they prepared to switch from using the legacy systems to using the new services provided by us or by other teams for some things. And they really built everything behind the feature toggle, and they could, for example, some teams have to do some quality measurements if they build, for example, URLs of product data. They compare how it works together with the with or how the old software builds URLs and how the new software builds URLs, and so they made use of the feature toggles. So if you have any questions, you can find my contact details here. I think I hope I can upload the slides somewhere after the talk, so you can see it there. And that was it from my side. Thanks for your attention. If you have any questions, please tell them. Or we can talk afterwards. If it's hard to see if there are questions. Lines of code is hard. It was several hundred thousand lines of codes before we split the software, and database tables. There haven't been so much tables, but we had our data model was designed a bit weird, so we have a lot of lines in the tables. For example, for every product attribute in every language, it was one line in the attributes table, and I didn't count them at all, but it was huge, and it was hard to see through the data. Okay, thank you.